be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, O merciful God, that your church, being gathered together in unity by your Holy Spirit, may show forth your power among all peoples to the glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. Listen to me, you that pursue righteousness, you that seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham your father, and to Sarah who bore you. For he was but one when I called him, but I blessed him and made him many. For the Lord will comfort Zion, he will comfort all her waste places, and will make her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Listen to me, my people, and give heed to me, my nation. For a teaching will go out from me, and my justice for a light to the peoples. I will bring near my deliverance swiftly. My salvation has gone out, and my arms will rule the peoples. The coastlands wait for me, and for my arm they hope. Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look at the earth beneath. For the heavens will vanish like smoke, the earth will wear out like a garment, and those who live on it will die like gnats. But my salvation will be forever, and my deliverance will never be ended. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods will I sing your praise. I will bow down toward your holy temple and praise your name, because of your love and faithfulness.
Reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Prophecy in proportion to faith. Ministry in ministering. The teacher in teaching. The exhorter in exhortation. The giver in generosity. The leader in diligence. The compassionate in cheerfulness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do the people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said to him, "Some say John the Baptist, but others say Elijah. And still others say Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whoever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whoever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the true and living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. A teacher asks a question. What is the relationship between the angles in an isosceles triangle? When was the cell first discovered and by whom? For whom did Susan B. Anthony cast her illegal vote in 1872? And the room goes quiet. Everyone sits and waits, but no hands are raised. The air in the room grows thick with tension, The clock seems to slow down, and students look here, there, and anywhere except into the teacher's eyes. Maybe some of the students know the answer, but are too shy to speak up. Maybe some think they know the answer, but aren't sure enough to say it. Maybe some have absolutely no idea. They keep their eyes on the ground, willing someone to rescue them from this awkward silence. Finally, an arm goes up and a student answers. The two base angles in an isosceles triangle are always equal to each other. The cell was discovered in 1665 by Robert Hooke. Anthony cast her vote for Ulysses S. Grant. The teacher smiles and says, "Correct," and everyone breathes a sigh of relief. The right answer. Thanks be to God. Jesus asks a question, "Who do people say that I am?" And 12 hands go into the air. Isaiah, says one disciple. John the Baptist, says another. Jeremiah offers a third, or some other prophet. Jesus smiles and moves on to the next question. "And who do you say that I am?" And the room goes quiet. John starts shuffling his feet in the dust. James looks down and tries to be still enough to be invisible. Thomas affects a serious interest in what's going on across the street, and Judas chooses that moment to ask to use the restroom. No one raises a hand. Maybe some of them know the answer, but are too shy to speak up. Maybe some of them think they know the answer, but aren't sure enough to say it. Maybe some of them have absolutely no idea, but they wait, sweating it out, until suddenly Peter's hand flies into the air. "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus smiles and calls him blessed, and the other 11 breathe a sigh of relief. The right answer. Thanks be to God. It's not so unusual, this story. A teacher asking a challenging question and only one student being brave enough to risk answering. What is unusual in this particular lesson is the teacher's response to the right answer. Other teachers, after hearing the right answer, would keep teaching, exploring the topic, further elaborating on its meaning or importance. They would continue to talk about triangles or cell walls, or why Susan B. Anthony's vote was important not just as a statement about voting rights for women, but also as an affirmation of the work of the president whose first 4 years in office were marked by his tenacity in fighting for the safety and civil rights of Black voters in the South. Other teachers would use the right answer as a springboard into a deeper conversation about the subject matter. But Jesus is not other teachers. Jesus chooses this moment to shift the lesson entirely. Jesus starts teaching not about the subject at hand, but about the student who had answered the question. Instead of talking more about his own identity, who the Messiah is, or how this has come to pass, Jesus starts talking about Peter's identity. "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church." Jesus, in other words, isn't interested only in the right answer. Jesus is also interested in the one who was clear enough, brave enough, and faithful enough to say the right answer out loud. If I were to ask you at home right now, or those of you sitting in the chancel with me, who is it that you say that Jesus is? I bet I would see lots of hands fly into the air. And I'll bet that every single one of you would get the answer right. Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And that would be correct. And we would smile, and some of us might even breathe a sigh of relief. But that answer is only part of what Jesus is looking for. Jesus is interested in more than just that right answer. Jesus is also interested in you, in your being clear enough, brave enough, and faithful enough to say the right answer out loud. And Jesus knows that one of the primary ways that we do this is not by safely repeating Peter's answer to each other, but by living the answer each and every day. The truth is that whether we know it or not, you and I are answering Jesus' question all the time. Who do you say that I am? If someone were to look at us, at all the decisions that we make, at how we spend our money and our time, at how we treat our friends and our enemies, at how we care for the poor and the sick and those in prison, at how we steward the gifts of creation, at what we say and what we do, what would they think the answer to that question was? Who do you say that I am? Maybe my life says that I think that you are a caring but absent father figure who only appears in times of crisis and isn't interested in the intimate details of my life. Maybe my life says that I think you are an unbending and unforgiving judge who is ready to pounce on me if I take one step out of line. Maybe my life says that I think you are the leader of an extremely selective social club, and that if I don't look the right way or believe the right things or love the right people, then I risk being booted out of the fraternity of the chosen. Maybe my life says that I think you are a nice idea, but not one that makes much sense in the real world. Maybe my life says that I think you are fine on Sundays, but ultimately ignorable the other 6 days of the week. Maybe my life says that I think you are a delusion, a joke, a fraud. Our lives are always speaking about who we think Christ is. Whether or not we are answering that question with our lips, our lives are speaking volumes about what we think about the one we say we follow. If we claim our baptisms, call ourselves disciples, and believe that Jesus is who he says he is, then our lives should speak those truths with clarity, courage, and faith. In other words, our lives should look different, as conspicuous as Peter's did. This is what Paul is getting at in his letter to the Romans when he exhorts his readers to not be conformed to this world, but transformed by the renewing of their minds. In other words, don't just sit there holding the right answer in your head, but sharing it with no one. Raise your hand. Live that answer out loud so that anyone who sees you can see and know that there is a Messiah who saves them, chooses them, loves them. Live a life that says that you believe in this Messiah, that you see this Messiah revealed in the person of Jesus Christ, and that you trust that this Messiah has a mission for you to employ your gifts, whatever they might be, to pursue righteousness and to seek the Lord and the Lord's kingdom. So listen, you who are searching for the right answer. Your teacher has already given it to you and is just waiting for you to say it. Mercifully, he is a teacher with infinite patience. He will wait for you for as long as it takes. He will sit in that awkward silence, watching you do everything you can to avoid his eyes, listening to the sound of the time ticking by. And he will ask you again and again and again and again, "Who do you say that I am?" He will give you the chance to answer that question again and again and again and again. He is asking right now, waiting expectantly for the moment when he can look upon you and smile and cry out, "Blessed are you," and call you by name. He is asking right now, looking at you with infinite love, his eyes encouraging you, strengthening you, calling you. Raise your hand. You know the right answer. Speak what you know out loud. Go on. Say who I am. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us stand and confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray in the name of Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of the living God, responding to Holy One with hear our prayer. For the church, especially Michael, our presiding bishop, and Jeffrey, our bishop, for the bishop's search and nomination and transition committees, Erica, our rector, our assisting priests and deacons, and all in religious life, for Charlie, who continues to provide excellent music weekly, for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, and in the Anglican cycle of prayer for the Church of the Province of Southeast Asia and their Bishop Melter, that we may boldly profess Jesus as Lord and help others come to know him. Holy One,
hear our prayer.
For this parish family of Atonement, for Margaret and Greg, our wardens, and for our vestry, for Kate and Aaron, who keep us connected in our time away, that our profession of faith in Jesus may be made in deeds and actions that show to all the power of God's love. Holy One,
hear our prayer.
For our families, friends, companions, and all whom we love, in thanksgiving for all celebrating birthdays this week, for the wedding anniversary of Bill Hancock's and Peter Benitez, and the first vow anniversary of Brother Joseph Basil Gauss, BSG, that the wisdom and knowledge of God may open our minds and hearts to honor and respect the dignity of every human being. Holy One,
hear our prayer.
For all who exercise authority in government, education, or business, that they may live and act in the grace of Jesus and the love of God, and promote justice and the common good for all. Holy One,
hear our prayer.
For healing in cities and neighborhoods, that God will guide leaders in addressing issues of racism, discrimination, and injustice, turn hearts from violence, and open pathways that will lead to reconciliation. Holy One,
hear our prayer.
For the people of Beirut, Lebanon, the dead and wounded and those whose homes were lost in the horrific explosion earlier this month, Holy One,
hear our prayer.
For all serving in our military, especially Andre, Rike, Owen, Terrence, and Max, and all wounded warriors, for first responders in Chicago and throughout the country, especially for firefighters in California, and all those dealing with evacuations, power outages, and excessive temperatures in the wildfire emergencies. Holy One,
hear our prayer.
For those who suffer from fear during this pandemic, for those who are addicted or lonely, and for the needs of the sick, the dying, and the grieving, remembering all on our parish prayer list, at this Mass, we pray in particular for all those with COVID-19 and for Janice, Art, James Priest, Newman, Stephen Religious, Michael W., and Richard Thomas Religious. May hope prevail in this time of uncertainty as we remember doctors and nurses known to us, Joseph Basil, Jackie, Gary, Will, Choi, Erica K., Larry, Kieran, Lee, Carrie, Anthony, William, Eric, Lisa, and Thomas, and all essential workers, especially Dwayne, Tommy, Scott, Rose, Cecil, and Robert, that God will deliver the human race from the coronavirus, heal those who are ill, and inspire those who are developing cures or vaccines. Holy One,
hear our prayer.
For students, teachers, and administrators beginning a new academic year, may this be a time of safety for them, and may they be able to grow from their sharing so as to make wise decisions and choices. Holy One,
hear our prayer.
In communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Bartholomew the Apostle, Augustine, Bishop of Hippo, Blessed Gregory the Great, and all the saints, let us offer our prayers to all who have died. Remembering all on our parish prayer list, at this Mass, we pray in particular for David Allen, religious and priest, Maureen Conlon, and Ralph Osborne, that they may receive their reward in heaven and see God face to face. Holy One,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, to whom our needs are known before we ask, help us to ask only what accords with your will, and those good things which we dare not or in our blindness cannot ask, grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace. Good morning.
Peace with you, Charles.
With you. Good morning,
Ron.
Peace. Peace,
good morning to everyone. Peace.
Peace, girl.
With you. Thank you.
Everyone.
Peace, everybody.
Peace. Peace with you.
Peace. Hey, Desmond. Peace,
everybody.
With you.
Peace with you. All right.
Peace be with you.
Hi, Norma. Peace be with you. Peace, Mother Erica.
Morning, Mother Erica. I love the hairdo.
Thank you. Peace be with you all. So good to see you all here on the screen and here in the chancel. I'm so glad that you all are here with us. A special welcome if you're visiting with us for the first time in our Zoom worship. If so, I hope you come back again and again and worship with us here. We're continuing, of course, to have our liturgies at 9 o'clock in person on Sunday morning with registration ahead of time. All of that information is most easily found in our parish email that comes out every week on Thursday afternoon. If you're not yet signed up to get those emails, I hope that you'll be in touch with the office or with me so that we can add your name to that email list to make sure that you're getting all of that vital information, Zoom links for this worship, registration for the 9 o'clock liturgy, Zoom links for evening prayer at 6:30 on Tuesdays, which of course is open to all, Zoom links to the Thursday Bible study, which meets at noon. All of those are open to anyone, and all of those links are most easily found in that parish email. So I hope you'll sign up for that if you haven't already. As I'm talking about Zoom, I need to ask you all to seriously consider whether you might be able to assist us in our Zoom ministry team. Now, if you're here on Zoom, it means that you know how to sign into a Zoom conversation. Now, there might be some of you in this Zoom call who know a little bit more than that about Zoom. You're more facile, you've spent some more time on Zoom, maybe for work or for school. We really do need people to help us with the ministry team that is specifically for this liturgy and also for the coffee hour that follows this liturgy. We need people who know just a little bit about Zoom so that we can teach you a few extra of the tools and procedures that we use to make these Zoom conversations work. We are in need of people to help do that. We've started to put together a team, but we really need more people to help out. So if you are a person sitting there thinking, well, I know how to use Zoom, we would really appreciate your reaching out to me, to Margaret Sullivan, to the office, just to let us know that you could help us with that ministry team, that you'd be able to use your gifts to help us. Paul did not list that as one of his gifts in his list of gifts in the letter we just read to the Romans. But if he were writing it today, he would. He would say, for the Zoom person, you know, serving as a Zoom host. That's what he would say. So I hope that you can help us out with that. We really do need some help. So please do seriously consider that. You'll see listed there on the announcement sheet some outreach opportunities. First of all, we're continuing to collect money to provide backpacks for students here at the Swift School right around the corner. You know, they're meeting from home to start out with in this school year, but they don't know that might change. And even if it doesn't change, they still are in need of school supplies. So we've done really well in collecting money to donate for these backpacks. If you're able to give, you can donate very simply by going to our website. There's a link right there on our donate page that tells you how to contribute to a certain number of backpacks. The other thing is that Francesca's down the street, the wonderful restaurant that's been so supportive of our ministries here, is doing a fundraiser for nursing, for nurses, wherein you buy a meal that's then donated to nurses. And it's a wonderful opportunity for us to not only contribute to people who've been working very hard during this pandemic, but also to support Francesca's, which has been so supportive of us. So this is one of the ways that we can be a good neighbor. More information about both of those opportunities is in that parish email. So do check that from Thursday, or if you're not on the list, let us know so that we can get you all that information. We are continuing to have that Mass at 9 o'clock on Sunday mornings, and we'll continue that through the month of September. It's going very well. We're sending out surveys so that we can hear a little bit more about people's experience of that Mass. You may have seen this past week also that we're sending out a survey for anybody who comes to this Mass. We're very curious to know. We've made some changes in the past couple of weeks. We know we've struggled with the audio, but aside from that, how is this working for you? There are some really interesting questions in that survey, and we really would like to hear your thoughts and get your suggestions. So if you saw that in the email this week, please go ahead and fill it out. It will only take you a moment or two. If you didn't see it this week, don't worry. We'll include it again next week so that we can get more information from you so that we know as we move forward into the fall what changes we might need to make and really what's really important to you as the church as we continue this virtual worship together. Thank you, as always, for your giving. You can give online, or you can always mail us a check. Aaron's putting the link there where you can donate online. Many of you are doing that. It is very helpful. And we're so grateful to you for continuing to express your generosity through your giving to the ministries of this place. And I look forward to seeing you all after the Mass at our virtual coffee hour. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts. Thank you.
and also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, blessed Gregory the Great, and all your saints, into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.